Welcome to the Spiritual Fortitude Podcast. This episode is I Can Do All Things in Him Who Strengthens Me by Father George Montague. God bless and enjoy.
I'm very glad that you prayed a blessing over me because I need that blessing in order to speak, but we also need that blessing in order to hear. And I was taught something by that. By the way, how many of you have heard me speak before? Okay, well, I just have to know that to know what jokes not to tell. But many years ago, when I first got in the renewal, way back in the 70s, we had an introductory session before each prayer meeting for those who, good Catholics, or maybe even some Protestants, mostly Catholics who would come. And the purpose of that was to make sure that they didn't get too much of a shock when they actually went into the prayer meeting. So I would try to explain things, what praise was, why it was so important to praise God, and what the baptism of the Holy Spirit was, and all that sort of thing. Well, there was a Pentecostal minister who came, and every Thursday, he would sit in the back row and listen to me. And after about a month of that, I asked him, I said, you know, you come every week, and I say the same thing every week, and why do you keep coming like that? And he said, well, he says, I like to see how the Catholics do it. And then he said, but my real reason for coming there is to pray for you while you're speaking. Oh, I said, and I pray that the Lord will really touch somebody in that audience. And you know, the one that he most often touches is me. My goodness, at that moment I felt convicted of all the sermons that I had set through as an art critic, saying, you know, the priest, gosh, he had 3 points and now he's on the seventh. He had a wonderful stopping place 5 minutes ago, but he missed it. But you know, I started then saying, how should I listen when somebody's speaking about the Lord? And I started praying for the speaker, whether it's giving a homily or listening to a talk like this. And you know what I discovered? It's amazing how much shorter the sermons became. It was amazing. And so, now, the reason I say that is very important. What is important is not what I say, it's what you hear. It is what you hear. I can do all things in him who strengthens me. This is the word of St. Paul. And today we are celebrating, as you know, the feast of the beheading of John the Baptist. Now, if there was anybody who had the strength to stand up against King Herod and to tell him that his divorce was out of order and to risk his own life and ultimately to give his life in witness to the gospel and witness to the truth, it was certainly John the Baptist. But I would invite you at this moment to use your imagination, maybe even close your eyes and use your imagination now to go to another prison. Not the prison of Machaerus where John the Baptist was being held by Herod. But this is a cell in a concentration camp during the Second World War in Poland. In Auschwitz, as a matter of fact. And one of the male prisoners has escaped. And the Nazis, in order to make an example of that, called everybody from that cell forward, stood them out in the open, and said, one of you must die in punishment for that man who escaped. And they went by lot, and they called out this one man, and he said, oh, I'm the father of the family. I have a wife and kids and children. He stepped forward. But there was a little old rye prisoner in the back who put up his hand and said, please, let me take his place. You know who that was. That was Father Maximilian Kolbe, now Saint Maximilian Kolbe. Certainly someone who could certainly say, I can do all things in him who strengthens me. And Father Kolbe, as you know, was put into a cell where he was starved to death. But he had the strength of Jesus. And that strength of Jesus is something that just goes beyond our natural strength. And that's what we're going to be talking about today. You know, some of us have great physical strength, and some of us don't. But that doesn't really count that much before God. What counts is the Spirit, because the Scripture says, not by might, not by power, but by my Spirit, says the Lord. Let's say that together. Not by might, not by power, but by my Spirit, says the Lord. I can do all things in him who strengthens me. And of course, for Father Colby, it was not just the Holy Spirit, but it was the Immaculate. It was Mary as well, to whom he had such great devotion. Now, I would like to talk then today, not so much about being able to do physical things. I had a parent just last Saturday. I was at a reception after a marriage, and this young man who had a little 4-year-old or 5-year-old son, and he told me that he had been teaching these children scripture verses. And this little boy at one point said, "Daddy, I want to go climb that tree." And that was very, very dangerous for him to do. And his daddy said, "No, you can't do that." And he looked at his daddy and he said, "I can do all things in him who strengthens me." Well, we're not talking about just the ability to climb a tree or to climb a hill or climb a mountain physically. Although sometimes the Lord gives us the strength to do those things. He said in Mark, the end of the chapter of 16 of Mark, the very end of the gospel, it says that people will even be able to drink deadly poison and it won't hurt them, it won't harm them. So the Lord sometimes gives us ability to do even physical things that are beyond our power. And that was taught to me. I'm a scripture scholar, and when I teach that particular passage about drinking poison and it not harming them, I said, "Now, that doesn't mean you can go out and tempt God to do that. But if you do something foolish or somebody gives you poison or something like that, you should pray to the Lord." Because, see, I was 6 years in Nepal. I was a missionary over in Nepal, and that's where Mount Everest is. That's where the great Himalayas are, you know. And in October, we would take our novices out on trekking. And trekking means you walk along the hills, the foothills, which go up to 15,000 feet, by the way. And you just get beautiful views of the mountains, all right? So, but you stop at these little, they call them hotels, but they're just little places where you can lay down overnight and maybe have a bite to eat or something and go on. Well, we always took iodine along with us to put in our water to purify the water. Just you put 5 drops of iodine into your canteen, and you shake it up a little bit and let it sit for half an hour, and then you can drink it because the water over there is very bad. Well, because we wanted to get an early start on Sunday morning, we were out in the middle of the hills out there, and so we had Mass on Saturday night, so the vigil, the Saturday night Mass for the Sunday, and we had brought along wine for that. Now, the iodine that we had brought along was Lugol's iodine, which is double concentrated iodine, okay? Well, at 5 o'clock in the morning, I'm getting up, and it's pitch dark, and our little cabin, everything was shut anyway, so there was no light getting in, and I was putting my stuff into my bag, my backpack. And I looked at this little container, and there was a little bit something about that much in it, about an inch in it. And I said, "You know, I thought I drank all our wine last night." I said, "That's strange." I said, "Well, there's no sense in just carrying this along, so I'm just going to chug-a-lug it, you know, to get rid of it." I said, "This is the strangest tasting wine I've ever had." And then I said, "Oh my God, I just drank poison. I just drank all the iodine that we had. Oh my gosh." Well, you've heard of Kubler-Ross's 5 stages of dying? Well, my first stage was, I didn't do that. No, that didn't happen. That didn't happen. Well, that didn't last too long because I know it did happen. All right. Well, then, The next stage, of course, was I was so angry at myself. I was, how could I have done such a stupid thing like that? Now, I come from a religious order that was founded in Bordeaux, which is famous for wine, you know. And I can see my French brothers saying to me, ha, these Americans, they don't even know the difference between wine and die-die, you know. So, but then I said, well, you know, I guess when you don't have any place else to turn, you turn to the Lord, you turn to the Scriptures. And I called everybody out. I said, come on, let's pray, let's pray. He says, I just drank poison, I just drank iodine. I said, but Jesus said, if they drink anything deadly poison, it's not going to harm them. I said, so let's pray. So we praised the Lord, we prayed. Do you know, I had no reaction to the iodine, whatever. Not even any burning in the stomach, nothing. Praise God. Hallelujah. So the Lord takes care of dumb people and Irishmen, and I kind of qualify as both, so I figure that's the way it works. Now, so the Lord, when he's talking about giving us power to do things, he's not always just talking about sometimes maybe power to do physical things beyond our ability. But he's talking about doing spiritual things beyond our ability. Now, if you were a disciple of Jesus, on that day when he, after working all the miracles and there are thousands of people following him, and he went up the mountain a little bit, and then his disciples came and made a circle around him, and then he preached. And how did he start off? He didn't start off by saying do's and don'ts, don't do this, don't do that. He started off, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are the meek, for they shall possess the land. Blessed are those who mourn, they shall be comforted. What is he talking about? He's talking about the kingdom of God that is coming. And this kingdom is open to those who can do it by the power of God, but not by their own power. Now he goes on and he tells his disciples who are gathered around him, he says, you are the salt of the earth. You are the light of the world. A city seated on a hill cannot be hidden. So let your good work shine before all, that is before the whole crowds, before the whole world, so that they may see your good works and glorify you. No, glorify your heavenly Father. Now, what then does he say he expects of his disciples? He doesn't say he expects it of the crowd, but he expects it of his disciples, which means they are committed to him, which means he expects us, okay? Number one, he says, Moses said, you shall not kill, but I say anyone who is angry with his brother or sister and doesn't get it straightened out is liable to Gehenna. Wow. Ooh. You mean, now, the old law didn't tell me that. I'm just supposed not to kill anybody. But I hate him? Oh, sure, I can hate him. No, Jesus says, you must be good in your heart as well as outside of that. Jesus says, further on, you must not even look with lust at a woman. Oh. You mean touches the heart? Yes. Ooh. Jesus, how am I gonna do this? And Jesus goes on, he lays some other things, and he finally ends up and he says, You've heard it said, you shall love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I say to you, love your enemies. Do good to those who persecute you and hate you. So that you may be children of my heavenly Father who makes his sun to shine on the just and the unjust alike and his rain to fall on the just and the unjust alike. So you're to be perfect just as my heavenly Father is perfect. Oh my God, you can imagine. You're sitting around him and you say, no. Oh Jesus. You know, if I were a disciple there, I think I would have been very tempted to say, Jesus, that's okay, but, you know, bye-bye. I'm going to go back to my old way of living. But Jesus expects that of us. You know, he didn't expect it of the crowd right away because he knew the crowd would have that answer. Sure, he had healed them. They were attracted to him because of what they got from Jesus, of the healings they got from Jesus, and they wanted to hear more. But then, the impossible dream. But no, Jesus says, look at my disciples if you want to see that it can be done. Now, at the very end of the gospel, Jesus tells his disciples as he's sending them out, he says, go make disciples of all the nations, teaching them to observe all that I told you. All that? Yes. But Jesus didn't say, that's all. He said, behold, I am with you all days, even to the end of the world. So, Jesus has those super expectations of us because he is with us. Amen? He is Emmanuel, and we can do what Jesus does and Jesus did because of Jesus' power in us. Amen?
Amen?
Amen. Praise God. Now, I want to show you a little bit how that works up, works out. Even in the Old Testament, you have David saying, with your help, I can scale any wall. Huh? Now, what weaknesses and what obstacles, what blocks us from really experiencing the full power of God? You know, St. Paul says he even boasts of his weakness, that the power of God may dwell in him. So we don't have to deny or pretend we don't have human weaknesses. We can even, in a sense, boast of them because we're going to let Jesus overcome them. Let's, if you have your Bibles, you might want to turn to 2 Corinthians. 2 Corinthians chapter 12. By the way, any talk that I give is a BYOB party. Bring your own Bibles. All right. St. Paul says that I might not become too elated, too proud, because of all the revelations that he has sent. A thorn in the flesh was given to me. Now, we don't know what this is actually referring to. It may have been a sickness, a weakness. We know when he came to the Galatians, he refers to that. And one time he says, you would have plucked out your eyes and given them to me. So it may have been some sort of a migraine, a headache or something like that. We don't know, migraine of the eyes or something. But it was some sort of a pain, some sort of a difficulty that he constantly had. He says, three times, I begged the Lord about this, that it might leave me. Huh? So even St. Paul wasn't delivered from everything, huh? And probably not from one of these physical infirmities. So in other words, people, you're not supposed to look down on people who have some physical infirmities and say, where's your faith? That's terrible. That puts a guilt trip on them. And that is not their call. Maybe they haven't prayed for healing. Maybe you need to pray for them for healing if they want to be prayed for healing. You know, some people don't even want to be prayed for healing. I know one of Mary's brothers, many years ago, he had all kinds of allergies to this. He was allergic to life, I think. And so I was visiting him, and because I was a provincial superior at that time, and I was saying, well, have you ever really been prayed with for healing? Would you like to be prayed with for healing? And he's kind of hemmed and hawed around. He says, I don't know whether I really want to be healed or not. Now the reason was that the whole rest of the community had to accommodate themselves to him. So he wasn't too sure whether he wanted to give up all those, those comforts that people were making out of it. Well, sometimes people don't. Well, I'm getting off the track. But at any rate, Scripture sometimes does that to me. Three times I begged the Lord that I might leave me, but he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for power is made perfect in weakness. Power is made perfect in weakness. Sometimes, you know, when I have to give a talk or something, I just feel completely out of it, completely dry, completely dead. And I say, Lord, I'm dry. You're going to have to provide the living water. And you know, that's when it really flows most of the time. It's when we just surrender ourselves totally to the power of God that we can do things that, or the Lord can use us to do things that we never had imagined that we could do. Power is made perfect in weakness. I would rather boast gladly of my weaknesses in order that the power of Christ may dwell with me. Therefore, I am content with weakness. Now, for him, weaknesses means all this beaten up that he gets. He says weakness, insults, hardships, persecution, constraints for the sake of Christ. For when I am weak, then I am strong. He says, when I am humanly weak, when I am physically weak, I then am strong. Even Job in the Old Testament, chapter 6, verse 11 says, have I the strength of stone? Have I the strength of brass? No, I'm just a weak human being by my own power. See, he realizes that by our own power, very often there are a lot of things that we cannot do. Now, what are the supernatural things, the things above nature that we are called to do? Well, Jesus says, you must forgive, you must love your enemies. That's a call to depend on the power of God, because that doesn't come naturally. Forgiveness doesn't. Our natural reaction when we are hurt is to get even. You know, we just must do that. That's the way we feel. Let me give you an example, and also to show you the power of the cross to achieve what we cannot do. Many years ago, a number of years ago, I was teaching theology in the summer theology program at St. Mary's University in San Antonio, where I now teach. And there was a sister who came every summer doing her degree program. She was a very bubbly kind of person. Her name was Rosemary, and she was the life of the party. But this particular summer when she came, she looked terrible. Her face was drawn. She never smiled. It was obvious that she was depressed. And so we had a kind of weekend retreat in the middle of the program, and I preached about forgiveness, and I shared the parable of the unforgiving debtor, you know, the one who had this terrible debt and his master wanted him to pay up and he couldn't pay, and so he's going to throw him in prison and so on. Remember that story? And then he goes out and he chokes a fellow servant, says, pay what you owe, just a fraction of his debt. Well, you know the rest of the story. Well, I read that, and after the talk, she came in to see me, and she says, I can't do it. I says, what can't you do? She says, I can't forgive. I said, well, you wouldn't have come in unless you wanted some help. She says, that's right. So tell me this story. 6 months previous, her brother, whom she really just worshipped practically because he was her closest friend, she just thought the Lord hung the stars on him because he was just so wonderful, so understanding. He had been killed in an automobile accident, and the man who was driving the car and who was responsible for her brother's death claimed that her brother was driving the car. Maybe this was for insurance purposes, whatever. But she knew he was not driving the car, but he tried to claim that. Well, number one, she was grieving, of course, for the loss of her brother and her best friend. But she also was bitterly angry and resentful and against this man who could dare to do what he did, to claim that her brother was driving the car. And I said again, well, you know, you must have had some reason for coming in here if you wanted some help with this. So I suggested to her, look, why don't you just kneel down here, and I want you to hold the crucifix, a little cross like this. Hold the Lord, the crucifix in your hand, and you look at Jesus, and you just let yourself imagine what he's going through. His hands and his feet nailed to the cross, blood flowing down from his head from the crown of thorns, pain all over his body. And you see Jesus looking with love on the Roman soldiers and even on those of the Jewish authorities who had condemned him. And he said, "Father, forgive them. They don't know what they're doing." Now you just focus on Jesus and realizing that in your own self you don't have the power to forgive. You ask him for the power to forgive. And then I want you in your imagination to see this man who killed your brother coming into the room, and he's right here beside you. And when you feel that with the power of Jesus you have the strength, I want you to turn to that man and say, "In the name of Jesus, I forgive you." Well, it took some time. This wasn't automatic. It wasn't a magical kind of thing. She struggled and struggled, but she kept her eyes fixed on Jesus. And eventually she turned and she said, "In the name of Jesus, I forgive you." Now, when she stood up, it was as if a ton of bricks was taken off her shoulders, and for the first time that summer she smiled. She was delivered, and it was the power of the cross. She had experienced what St. Paul says, "We preach Christ crucified. The Jews look for signs, the Greeks look for wisdom. We preach Christ crucified, the power of God and the wisdom of God." Amen. And that's what she experienced. That was the power of the cross, the power of Jesus on the cross, giving her that power by the Holy Spirit poured out from the cross upon her at that very moment, and she was able to be liberated. I was on the van from the airport just this afternoon with a lady who's kind of into New Age stuff, and she was trying to evangelize us to the New Age movement, a particular form of it, which was really old Gnosticism, but reborn, you know. And but we did agree on one thing, and she said this. She said, we focus on forgiveness. I said, "Yeah, that's our business too." But she said, "That's exactly what the world needs, is the ability to forgive." There was a sister in, I think it was in Bosnia, when all that ethnic conflict was going on there. And I remember she said on television, she was in Bosnia and she was working with those people. I think she'd worked with those people for a long time. And there's so much ethnic conflict there. There had been for centuries. She says the only way that peace is going to come about, lasting peace, is going to be through forgiveness. To not be a prisoner of the past, but to let go of the past. But you see, that takes the grace of God. And what is not possible to the human heart is possible by the grace of God. Amen. Amen. It is possible by the cross of Jesus Christ. Amen. It is possible by this God who loved us so much that he sent his only begotten Son that we might have life everlasting. And if only the people in Iraq, if only the people in the Holy Land, if only the people in Afghanistan, if only the people all over the world could come to the foot of the cross and ask for the power to forgive, ask for the power to let the past be the past and let it go, there would be peace in the world. Amen. 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 That's what the world needs more than anything else, is healing and forgiveness. And that's through the power of Jesus that is available to us, brothers and sisters, through the power of Jesus. Don't hold on to those things that have you entrapped in the past. A number of years ago, I was preaching a retreat in South Texas. And again, I talked about forgiveness, and I used that parable about the unforgiving debtor. And after it, a lady came up to me and she said, "You know, God spoke to me while you were talking about the Word of God there, about forgiveness. God spoke to me. I have to tell you this story. My husband was in the Vietnam War, and when he came home, it was a kind of a psychological wreck. He became violent. And at one point, he hit me over the head, and he hit right where the bobby pin was, and that hurt terribly. She said, I took out that bobby pin and I put it in a little crack in the wall by my refrigerator where I could see it every day. That bobby pin has been there for 27 years. But Father, I'm going home and throw it away. I have forgiven my husband. Praise God. Now you see, that's what the Word of God can do. It gives us the power to do the things that we can't just normally do by our own strength. And sometimes that's other things like confronting somebody. You know, I kind of grew up in a family that was very affirming, okay? And I just praise and thank God for that, because I have had a good self-image from childhood, okay? Because our family was very affirming. But there was one area where our family was deficient, and that is things would come up that ought to have been confronted, but we were afraid to confront. And we would walk around the corpse in our living room, you know, and nobody would ever say, "You know, hey, did you know that there's a corpse in our living room?" The problem of confronting the problem, you know. But you see, had we turned to the Lord and gotten the power to do it, we would have been able to do it. And it would have solved a lot of problems. It would have solved a lot of problems if we had been able to do it. But the power, brothers and sisters, of Jesus on the cross, the power of God and the wisdom of God, that's what we have here in this cross. The cross is not a symbol of defeat. It's a symbol of victory. Let's say that. Victory. The cross is a symbol of victory. The cross is a symbol of victory. It is the symbol of the victory over Satan. Jesus said, now is the prince of this world cast out. And he said that the night before he died upon the cross. And this is where the prince of the world was cast out. During his public life, Jesus cast out many demons. But in the Gospel of John, there is just one exorcism that Jesus does. And it's the exorcism on the cross where he casts out once and for all the prince of this world. Amen.
Amen.
Now, the prince of the world is the one that keeps us bound. But this cross, you know, I don't know whether you do, but even as a priest, sometimes I have questions about my faith, you know. I mean, there are moments where I said, for example, one day, just this past year, well, a few months ago, I was lifting up the host at Mass. And I said, is this really possible that this is Jesus? Really Jesus, the Son of God, body and blood, soul and divinity? It's just a question that I asked. And you know, I just heard the Lord say to me, do you think that I love you so little that I wouldn't do this for you? Wow. Solved all my problems. See, God could do that. And he loves me with infinite love. So why not? You see, the miracles of God can be explained by the love of God. God is insanely in love with us, and therefore he does the things that God can do. He doesn't just do things that our parents or friends can do for us. He just doesn't give us gifts that they can give to us. You know, I teach at the university, but I live in a parish. And when you live in the parish, when you're a priest in the parish, oh my gosh, Christmas time comes around, people give you all kinds of gifts that you don't need. You know? I've gotten, you know, things for shaving. You know, maybe they were suggesting that I should shave. And the other day, I got two shirts from two different people. And I think they were suggesting it was about time that I would, you know, wear a new shirt. Because I usually wear white shirts in Texas because I perspire, you know. And if you wear these black things, you get a white shirt right away with the salt, you know. So I wear white shirts most of the time. Well, people gave me two white shirts. I think it was because my old shirts were beginning to become see-through shirts, you know. Well, but you see, the gifts that God gives, they're not things that you need, physically things that you need. It's those graces. We call it the Holy Spirit, right? The Holy Spirit's the sum of all the good things, all the gifts of God. And God gives us the Holy Spirit. Man, there's nothing like the Holy Spirit. Holy smokes. Listen, the Holy Spirit. Look, brothers and sisters, stop to think about what the gift of the Holy Spirit is. The Holy Spirit's the power of God, right? I mean, power is dunamis, dynamite, you know? Okay. Well, now look, think of all the people in the world who don't know God. I mean, there are billions of them. And those who think they do know God, it's a kind of a, you know, the force be with you or something like that, you know? And then they're the polytheists. They're those who believe in all kinds of gods. Gods for this and gods for that. Then there are the monotheists who believe that there's only one God. The Muslims and the Jews and the Christians, all right? But among the monotheists, there are those who don't believe that God is Father. The Muslims believe in the Creator God, and they believe that He's the Merciful One, and so on. But they believe it's blasphemous to talk to God as Father, to call God Father. But that, brothers and sisters, is the revelation of Jesus. When you stop and think and look out and you say, yes, there is a God who made this universe. And when you think of the extent of this union, 13 billion light years away, staggers the imagination. You can't even imagine that. And we're just getting the light now that started 13 billion years ago and is finally hitting the earth. Wow. Now, that God is revealed to us as our Abba, as our Daddy. That's the gift of the Holy Spirit. Talk about power. And it's not only God's love, but it's the interpersonal love of the Father and the Son. It's that personal, interpersonal love between the Father and the Son that has been going on for all eternity. That's the explanation of this whole universe. That's the explanation of all of us, our very existence from this God. And yet, by the gift of the Holy Spirit, you know what happened? We are pulled up and brought into that very embrace between the Father and the Son. We are embraced by the same love that the Father has for the Son. That's incredible. Because St. Paul tells us, because it's by the Holy Spirit that we can cry out, Abba, Father. But that's Jesus in us crying out, Abba, Father. You just got to be thinking about that forever. Okay. But let me talk about the power of this cross. You know, I started telling you about sometimes questions that I have. Well, the other question, you know, that I had, you know, Lord, I was hearing confessions at a retreat. We have a retreat movement in San Antonio called Acts Retreat Movement. It's very powerful. It's renewing many parishes. And I was hearing confessions. And I was in a kind of a darkened room. There was another confessor over another corner, and I was over here. The room was rather darkened. But there was a doorway to a room that was adjoining, and just beyond there was a crucifix, a beautiful crucifix hanging on the wall, rather large crucifix hanging on the wall, illumined. And I was listening to this gentleman, and not only this man, but other men were coming. This was a men's retreat. Other men were coming, and they were in tears. They were so much repenting for their sins, so deeply touched by the word of God, they were weeping. Now, you know, men are not supposed to cry, right? I mean, that's the myth. But these men were weeping. And I said, God, what's happening here? And I looked up and I saw the cross. I said, thank you, Jesus. This is what the cross of Jesus is doing right here and now to these men, converting their hearts, touching them. Jesus, the love of God and the power of God, Jesus Christ, touching them. That's where the power really takes place. And brothers and sisters, if only the whole world would experience that kind of conversion, falling on their knees, weeping for their sins, forgiving their neighbor, forgiving God, forgiving themselves, the world would be changed. But that's the message of love that we have. We preach forgiveness, we preach love, we preach the peace of God, and that is the way that the kingdom is going to come. And we're all ambassadors of that kingdom. And that means that we have first of all received it, experienced it ourselves, the power of God. A woman came to me a couple of weeks ago, two or three weeks ago, and she was burdened. She was worried. She had confessed all her sins, but she still had this sense of guilt. She was still beating up herself for what she had done. And this was self-flagellation. And I said, my dear, all of us have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, as Paul says. Focus not on your sins, but focus on the immense mercy of God. You see, the angels express or witness to the justice of God, right? Because some of them made one bad decision, and they never revoke decisions that they make, angels don't. They made one bad decision, which was an eternal decision, and they experienced the justice of God. And that's why we're bothered by them, by the way. All right. They're called demons, all right? But we, I believe, as human beings, are called to witness the mercy of God. Oh, we can witness to the justice of God if we prefer to do that. But that's not as comfortable at all. But we're called to witness the mercy of God. And every one of us can proclaim that mercy of God. No matter how dark our sins have been, as Isaiah says, even though your sins be red as scarlet, they'll become white as wool, whiter than wool. That's the mercy of God. So there's no room for flagellation. But Satan has another weapon that he likes to use, and that's the weapon of, no, you can't do it, or maybe you shouldn't do it. You can't do it. You see, I went through a lot of discernment about starting this new charismatic order called the Brothers of the Beloved Disciple. One of our brothers is here. He's going to be attending the young adult thing. You'll see him in a kind of a blue poncho kind of habit. And he's a deacon. He'll be ordained priest next year. I went through a long time of discernment about this. And very often, you know, you say, well, no, you shouldn't do it. Or the devil kept saying, look, you're not holy enough. You're not holy enough to do this. You've been a sinner. You've done all these things. How could you possibly begin a new religious community and so on, you know? Well, eventually, I saw that as the temptation of the devil. Because, you know, if any of us would say the same thing, I'm not holy enough, I'm not good enough, that's the way Satan would love to stop us from doing the good things that he wants us to do. Huh? Then there's their fears. This is one of the things that very often keeps us, I think, more than anything else, from being the full Christian, the full disciple that Jesus wants us to be. And that's why we need the power of the Holy Spirit to overcome our fears. What word did Jesus say most often to his disciples? Do not be afraid. Do not be afraid. And you know Pope John Paul II? That's one of his favorite sayings. Do not be afraid. If you read his book called The Threshold, Crossing the Threshold of Hope, do not be afraid. Go ahead. Don't be afraid of the situations in the world, because God is with us. Well, as I told you, I was a missionary in Nepal, also in India. During the Christmas holidays, I would usually preach a 10-day retreat down in India, in Patna, in India, northern India. And during one of the conferences, I just felt moved by the Holy Spirit to talk about fears. And we had about 100 people, over 100 people there making the retreat. And I said, how about calling out what kind of fears do people have here? So I started writing them on the board, and they started coming so fast, I needed some help with some other people to put them up. Let me share with you some of the fears. I got a whole list of them here, but maybe you can identify with one of the other ones. Now, a couple of them are typical of India, but the rest might work here too. Fear of rejection, fear of negative remarks, fear of being scolded, fear of being yelled at, fear of being punished, fear of being threatened.
Fear of getting onto a bus, a car, or a train, or a plane, we would say. I was sitting right next to a couple coming up here. He hadn't been flying for about 20 years, and she was just, her knuckles were white. She was just scared to death about in the plane. And she looked over at me and she said, "Are you a priest?" And I said, "Yes." "Oh, thank God." Really, you know, she was out of breath. She was just scared to death. And I said, "Well, you want me to pray with you?" "Oh, yeah, okay." So I prayed with them. I prayed a blessing on them, and I prayed that everything. And they were fine, you know, no problem at all. But fear of taking off on a plane, you know, okay. Fear of being threatened. Fear of missing the transport. You know, I sometimes have a dream about this. I'm getting ready, packing up to get to the plane, and I don't know, I'm always getting blocked, never getting there in time. Anyway, afraid of arriving late, afraid of working with a particular person. Ha-ha, I don't ask you to raise your hands, but... Then, fear of insects, fear of bees, wasps, snakes, bats, mice, lizards. Fear of elephants. Ha-ha. India. Yeah, they really... In India, there are wild elephants, you know, that will roam around even the villages and so on. And once in a while, you know, people over there make rice beer. They make beer out of rice. And sometimes they leave the cans in a place where elephants could get to them, you know, outside. And these elephants come and they get drunk. And then they tear up the houses. They can just destroy a house, you know. By the way, since we're talking about elephants, I have a little teaching about healing of memories and forgiveness. In Bangladesh, this is a true story. In Bangladesh, a train was kind of coming through a jungle and bumped an elephant calf. Well, you can imagine the mother was very upset with this. But the train went on. But the next time a train came down that track, the mother elephant was standing in the middle of the track. The train finally stopped. The mother elephant started beating on the engine, and she destroyed the engine. She completely paralyzed the train. 500 passengers left stranded out in the jungle. You know, they say elephants have a good memory. Well, see, her calf was hurt. But it wasn't this train that hurt. It was one that looked like it, you know. And doesn't that often happen with us? We were hurt by some superior, let's say, or an employer or something like that, or maybe by our father. And then anybody who comes across the screen of our consciousness that looks a little bit like that person, pow! Get it, you know? Okay. Fear of elephants. Fear of wild animals, fear of water, floods, crowds, being drowned, lost, fear of transfer. Being alone in a house or a big building, fear of electricity going off, which happens very often in India. Fear of police, because over there so often there's so much corruption. Fear of dacoits. Dacoits are burglars, robbers. Accidents, blood. Fear of blood. Fear of injection. Fear of hospitals. Fear of eating certain foods. Fear of liars. Fear of fat people. Fear of lean people. Fear of ghosts, fear of men, fear of women, fear of strong characters, fear of moody people, fear of angry people, fear of loud people, fear of drunkards, fear of mad people, dogs, high altitudes, low places, thieves, crossing the streets, jungle, confronting someone, asking for things, fear of getting no authority, fear of authorities, working with talented people, more talented people, lightning, storms, darkness, fear of breaking a vow, fear of committing a mistake, fear of studies, fear of sharing in groups, fear of making language mistakes, fear of owning our own remarks, fear of passing through certain places, fear of dead bodies, fear of a curse, fear of being misunderstood, fear of being ridiculed, fear of giving a unprepared talk, fear of going too long in your talk. I better stop there. But one of them I have to share is fear of getting out of bed in the morning. Somebody had that particular fear. Now, what I'm saying to you, and I'm taking the cue here from my good master of ceremonies here. I have to tell one more story I have to finish with. A dear young lady that I met in Steubenville many years ago, had grown up in a terrible family situation. It's a very dysfunctional family. Her father was a very angry person and so on. And later on, she had been also sexually abused by somebody that she had really trusted in authority. She was a mess. She was an absolute mess. Well, I prayed with her, and I continue to pray with her, but she has grown enormously. But when I left Steubenville, I was praying with her and just hoping that with the grace of God, she would survive and grow. And a little bit later, she sent me a little embroidered picture where she had embroidered, "My grace is sufficient for thee." My grace is sufficient for thee. I said, praise the Lord. I really kept that picture. It's a very precious thing because she believed what this whole talk is all about, that God's grace is sufficient for us. You don't know the power you have in the Holy Spirit. The power is given to you. And one final example. I usually have three finals in... A friend of mine down in Florida was going to get his wife a car, a used car, for a second car in the family. And he went to a car dealer and he says, "Well, I've got a former police car here, which is in very good shape, and if you'd like to buy it." Well, he bought it. Okay. So after that, she drove around town, no problem, found it very, very nice. But one night she was coming home. She was coming home from somewhere, but she was down a country road. She was dark country road. And there was a pickup that came behind her and came up real close, then pulled around and slowed down. And then she passed him, and then he would come around, do the same thing to about three times. Well, she was extremely frightened. And the third time, she got out like this and she just floored it, not realizing that this car was provided with a police overtake. And in just a matter of seconds, the headlights of this pickup was just a little speck in her rear mirror, and she was gone. Now, all of us have that passing gear. It's called the Holy Spirit. And the Holy Spirit's got us that power if we use it. That power that even teaches us how to pray. We don't know how to pray, we're supposed to, but we've got the Holy Spirit that teaches us. Now, if you want some final encouragement about praying, I'm going to finish with this word of God from St. Paul in Romans 8. What can we say after this? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but handed him over for us all, how will he not also give us everything else along with him? Who will bring a charge against God's chosen one? It's God who acquits us. Who will condemn? It is Christ Jesus who died, rather was raised, is also at the right hand of God, who indeed intercedes for us. Who will separate us from the love of Christ? Anguish or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or the sword? Paul is writing to Rome, and that's the way he's going to end his life, unknowingly, when he wrote this letter, but it was providential. No, in all these things we conquer overwhelmingly through him who loved us. The love of God is our power. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels nor principalities, nor any of these fears that I read to you, neither death nor life, nor angels nor principalities, nor present things, nor future things, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. Praise God. Thank you.
This presentation has been recorded by the SCRC Ministry. All rights are reserved.